how did you collaborate with Erin once you had the script?
Well, there was the first issue was just setting and moving it to Toronto, and Erin's very much, you know, someone who's raised in San Francisco, knows that milieu very well, and the first version of the script was really reflective of San Francisco and places that I knew as a tourist, and certainly mm-hmm. I was attracted to, because like anyone else, I mean, it'd be great to shoot a film in San Francisco, but as it became more serious, I realized that I know how these people would live in this city, mm-hmm. And it could be made in the city, and the city's never really been used that way. Mm-hmm. So that idea of incorporating Toronto as a character was really exciting. I mean, I think as a filmmaker, you want to feel like you're exploring new territory. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, psychologically and in terms of narrative, but if you can also situate it in a place that hasn't really been seen in that way, then that makes it so rich with possibility.
Yeah, if you shot in San Francisco, it almost would read Hitchcock from step one.
It, weirdly enough, wouldn't it? Because yeah. Someone said to me, like, yeah, there's, especially now with the score, and you know, like there's a feeling of you know, yeah, I think any story about kind of projection and obsession and has got to refer back to Vertigo at some level, right? Yeah. And I've done that tour, right? Crazily enough, you know. So, I mean, I know that the city from that perspective, but. That wasn't the reason why. I mean, it was really just to root it in something specific and real.
And how did you come upon this, Erin?
Well, I think my agent, Rowena Arbella, saw it at TIFF and sort of whispered in the ear of Ivan's company to have a look at this. Mm-hmm. And Ivan, I think, fell in love with the idea of making it into an adaptation, mm-hmm. In America, North America. And I put it in San Francisco because I'm from there, so I know it very well. I mean, mm-hmm. the first time I talked to Adam, he was like, well, you know, I see this, you know, panoramic shots of San Francisco. You know, he has this outsider's view of San Francisco, which has no relation to what mm-hmm. it is to be a San Franciscan. Mm-hmm. The same with Toronto or any city. You know, you don't know. You go there and you stay in the hotel and you don't know what it is. San Francisco is complex socioeconomically, culturally. It's a very snooty town in many ways. Mm-hmm. But it's also got this great, wonderful, vibrant underbelly, and I really wanted to explore that. And yet, when Adam came on board, which was a true gift beyond belief, I mean, I couldn't have imagined a better person than when Ivan said, "What about Adam Egoyan?" I was like, "Well, yes, mm-hmm. please, see if you can." But it's my. It was important to me that it become his film, that he not try to be me, or you know, I was me as much as I could while I wrote, mm-hmm. and I tried to make it mine. But then it had to become his. So now when people are mentioning in my interviews how to adapt it from San Francisco, I actually don't remember that it was in San Francisco. Mm. So I wanted it to be his. I wanted him to own it. I wanted him to work with his people. As I believe Ivan did too, and so we made the transition, which was, I believe, seamless. It didn't take much. Didn't it take a couple days of changing it? And you know everything. Ivan knows everything. They told me what to do, and I did it.
How did you end up in a relationship with Montecito Film Picture Company?
Well, another real amazing gift, and it seems like an odd one, you know, it was simple. It was, I got a call from Ivan. He was scouting locations in Vancouver. He said, "I want to do this film," and I said, "Oh, I'd love to do the film because, but I didn't pitch very much, and then we were doing it. And the amazing thing about...
So he came to you with this one specific piece of material.
Yeah. They thought of you. I had never met him before. I'd never seen him before, mm-hmm. you know, until we started to work together. And then we embarked on this very close collaboration, which, you know, is the secret to a great producer is to really work with the script. And, you know, I tend also towards what Adam tends towards, which is veiled or just never say the subtext, never say what's going on. Mm-hmm. You know, and I hold tight to it. And working with Ivan, he pushed me and mm-hmm. to pull it up to the surface more and more. And so it was kind of an amazing, you know, bringing together these three people mm-hmm. who would seemingly not be together, and we all three get along wonderfully, and we all three have different strengths.
Well, I guess from the outside, my perception would be that Ivan was the odd man out of this group.
No, he clearly wasn't.
I always say when people go, like, what have your films got anything to do with Ivan Reitman? I go, watch Dave really closely. Like, Dave is a very interesting movie about mm-hmm. marriage, about, you know, pretense, about projection. I mean, you look at those scenes with Sigourney Weaver watching Kevin Kline as a double or fake of her husband mm-hmm. falling in love with, you know, someone who she thought she knew, like reigniting. I mean, it's in my territory, mm-hmm. But it's light, comedic. Tonally, it's different, but clearly he's interested in marriages. He's interested in how we sustain fascination with people that we come to know very intimately. So it's...
with strong voices. I mean, I have a strong voice, you know, whatever you may think of it, and Adam obviously does too. So he's willing to get in that room and fight.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
You know, I know that that Ivan and Adam argued, and I use the word argument, you know, meaning incredible dialogue. I had an incredible dialogue with Ivan, word by word of that script, mm-hmm. you know, and I fought, and then sometimes I'd go, all right, I'll say the monologue, I'll write it, say what she thinks. And I wrote it, and I really think we're talking about the monologue that Julie does at the end. Mm-hmm. And he told me last night that someone would have to put a gun to his head to write such a monologue.
Well, no, only because, I mean, I it's like, it's very, as you said, you bring subtext up, I really like that scene, but I could never have written it. I mean, I could not write that. Like, there's just no way.
And then I told him, well, I did have a gun to my head, and that's how I wrote it.
Yeah.